Hey guys, welcome to part two of Adventures in Blood Glucose. This is a quick video showing you the test results from eating various foods from a glycemic index chart, blood glucose response to different portion sizes, and what happens when you add fat to a meal. I'm measuring postprandial glucose response, meaning what my blood sugar does during and after a meal. The time on the x-axis is measured from when I started eating, and values are in both UK units of millimoles per litre and the US units of milligrams per deciliter. A normal response is to peak after 30 to 60 minutes and come back down, and we're interested in both the spike and the overall area under the curve, which is represented as milligram hours per deciliter. So first I tested a dose response relationship using pineapple juice. On four different mornings, I drank between 100 and 400 milliliters of pineapple juice on its own, and using a GlucoRX Nexus, I measured blood glucose every 30 minutes until it returned to baseline. I was quite pleased with how clear the relationship is. You can see that the curve gets bigger as I drink more of it. If you calculate the area under the curve and plot that against glycemic load, which is the glycemic index of the food multiplied by the grams of carbs it contains, you see a nice line. Now, my results might not be your results. A study of 800 people found that roughly 1 in 20 were carb insensitive, meaning that their blood glucose had the same behavior for different portion sizes. They also found that the gradient or steepness of the line varies depending on the individual. So some people can have higher carb meals without a huge reaction, while others are really sensitive to portion size. The second effect I wanted to show was food from across the whole spectrum of the glycemic index. This is a rating system of how much a food eaten by itself will impact your blood glucose relative to pure glucose, which scores 100. The pineapple juice I drank was probably around 60 to 65, and a 400ml portion of that had 50 grams of carbohydrate. I then selected higher and lower GI foods and matched the grams of carbohydrate. So I had to eat around 400 grams of garden peas on their own. They had a score of around 40 and they had a very small glucose response. Next was oatmeal at 50 to 55 and a baked potato, which has a GI around 76. Two foods that didn't fit this nice pattern that's emerging were a French baguette with a GI of 95. This climbed slower and was still elevated at 2 hours, but didn't have a huge AUC. And whole wheat pasta, said to be 32, which is supposedly lower than peas. This had a similar pattern to the baguette, but with a higher peak at 1 hour. The final effect is something the research has shown can influence the GI of a meal, and that's pairing it with lower GI foods such as fats. Taking the same portion of baked potato and adding fat in the form of 15 grams of grass-fed butter, my blood sugar had almost the same pattern but a much lower peak and an area under the curve roughly half of the baked potato on its own. This is something my wife found when adding creme fraiche to her chicken and white rice, and again this effect is something that might vary by individual. So what does this mean for you? It means if you're diabetic, then portion size might be as important as the type of food that you eat. It also means that rather than trusting these GI tables, you should test the foods that you eat and their impact on your blood glucose levels, and to do so as part of a meal that you'd actually eat day to day. It's about how the combination of foods in a meal influence your blood sugar levels, and as you've seen, something as simple as a portion of butter might give you a completely different result. If you aren't diabetic, then some research suggests that you shouldn't be too concerned about foods that spike your blood glucose and to instead focus on more important things like maintaining a healthy weight, eating nutrient-dense foods, and exercising regularly. Thanks for watching.